Rochelle Fosu. Welcome to Rochelle Fosu TV. I am thrilled. It is Women's History Month, and I have with me Avi Siskos, who is a guru, I would say, in women empowerment. And we are especially interested in talking this month about how women of color struggle with empowerment. And we more importantly are going to talk about how to work through that, break through that, and just be more empowered. How about that? Welcome, Avi.
Thank you so much, Rochelle. First of all, thank you so much for allowing me to be in your house, in your space. You know, when I was listening to your videos and seeing everything that you're doing, I'm like, wow, this is someone that I want to sit down and talk to. And especially, like you said, it's Women's Empowerment, Women's History Month. Right. We're in March. And talking about empowerment in the minority communities, I think, is so important. I'm Latina. I grew up, you know, as many Latinos and as well as a lot of people of color with a mentality that you know, things are difficult.
Right.
That things are it's hard to accomplish our dreams, hard to accomplish our dreams and the things that we want to do. So for me, any chance that I get to speak with other girls or set that message to other women of empowering them and truly pursuing their dreams, regardless of what our cultures might say, regardless of what our parents might say that, oh no, that's very difficult, or eso no se puede in Spanish. It's like, no, you can't do that, you know? So it's like sharing that message with other people, sharing our stories, you know, so like yes. that other people can become empowered and be able to make their dreams come true. Because I always say that the only thing that stops us between our dreams and making them a reality is the action that we put into
Agreed.
Them.
Absolutely.
So it's like,
Absolutely.
You just have to, you know, make an effort every day to make your dreams come true.
Yeah. And you know, I think it's historical, and sometimes we miss how much history has gone into where we are today, especially as women of color.
Right.
I had the fortune of growing up in Africa. Right. And there is a distinction.
I was about to say, why would you say fortune?
I would say that mm-hmm. because when I came to America, I realized that history for the African-American actually started in chains. If you hear the African-American experience described, it starts with slavery. It actually doesn't start with what happened before they got on the boat to come here. Typically, it starts there. The problem with that is it's hard to be empowered when you feel like your history started in chains.
And you don't really know your true history.
You don't know the legacy you come
right.
from. I had the opportunity to speak to a cohort at a really top entrepreneurial university here in Boston, actually. And one of the things I told them about was about a legacy building woman from African Ghanaian culture.
Really?
Who could have been one of their ancestors.
Right,
it was an
right.
all-woman business cohort. That could have been one of their ancestors.
Wow.
They didn't know that. And so when I say fortune, I say it in the sense of I got to learn ancient African history as a part of my education from kindergarten.
And that's also the conditioning and I would
right.
say conditioning, just because sometimes when you grow up, like I come from parents that are immigrants
right.
to this country,
Same
where life
here.
Is hard and
Same
things
here.
Are very hard.
Exactly.
You're already conditioned into that thinking.
Right.
So your conditioning came from a
right.
legacy of,
right.
you know,
exactly.
of kings and queens and
right.
all of this, you know, it's a completely different culture, as you said, from people coming
exactly.
from a legacy of chains where things are not possible.
Right, right. If your history starts... And for parts of the Caribbean, it's the same.
Yes.
Right?
That's very true.
Because, again, when you think back to where history started there, it doesn't actually start with where you came from.
Right.
It starts with you getting there, which a lot of times, if there are mixtures, includes slavery.
Right.
Or economic or physical enslavement. Right?
Right.
And so for me, when I say that, you know, it really did change my perspective. So even though I immigrated to America,
right.
I was already aware of the fact that there were many ancient African empires that ruled the world.
Right.
And who those people were and what they did. And so even though I came here, I had already been programmed differently, as
right,
you say.
Right, right, right.
And so I knew more. And I wish that as a part of our experience going forward, we're able to teach young minority girls more about women who came from all of the places that they really are from,
right,
who really have a heritage that's bigger than what they know. Because when you start with the experience of slavery or some form of enslavement, you don't have women anywhere in that mix, right?
Right.
Men will be at the top of the food chain and women really have no place. I mean, think about slavery here, right?
Right, right.
The families were separated. The women had to essentially, you know, sometimes mate with the slave masters.
Right.
Or just kind of take care of families by themselves. They were the last ones on the totem pole. Right.
With and anything to say, with
right,
rights, everything.
Right. And they were the last to get voting rights. Right. And so when you think about all the before African-Americans, obviously, but when you think about those things, then you say to yourself, wait a minute, right? Where did this really start?
Right. And I which think is, that's looking at the root of it.
Right. We have to start there. And often we don't.
And how do we change that mentality? Because that's the thing, you know, like patterns and conditioning start at such a young age,
right,
and they're generational. They're inherited.
Right.
I say that like the things that we learn from our family, they learned from their family,
right,
and it's passed down. How do we learn from that, break from that, and teach ourselves and our children and the future
right,
legacy
right,
to
right,
think everything is possible.
Right.
I am the creator. I can create the life of my dreams and truly make a difference in whatever way it is that you want to.
Right. Again, I think it's modeling, right?
Mm-hmm.
That behavior. And I think we were talking about this earlier. A lot of our parents either are not able to or don't choose to model that behavior.
Right.
Right? Again, I guess I must have really lucked out, right? And didn't even realize I was lucking out, right? Because I remember very vividly my grandmother raised me. And she was the medical director of the main hospital in Monrovia, Liberia.
So she already had a really big position. She
right,
was a woman.
Right. It didn't occur to me because that's all she was from when I knew myself.
Right, right, right.
That I would go into her office and she would sit behind this big desk. But I did not realize how not like that. That was unique.
Right.
But to me, it wasn't unique because it was my life. Right. And so I got to see her sitting behind a big desk at an early age.
Right. And she had the power, she had the title as
right,
well.
Right. And she owned businesses. She had
right,
taxi businesses that were, you know, in Liberia. So it was kind of like, okay, that's normal.
Right.
And then my mom actually had me very early. So she left me and went to college.
Right.
And she told her, leave the baby with me, go to college.
Right.
Where some other parents would have said, you have a family now.
Like, you need to take care.
Stay home.
Right.
Take care of this baby, find a husband or marry the guy and,
right, right,
you know, become a homemaker. Right. And her choice was, no, leave the baby with me. Go and finish your education. And when you're ready and financially able, come back and get your child.
Right.
Again, so my mom got the opportunity to go and finish her education. She got to come back and get a great job. So now when I bounced over to her house and her job,
same,
she was sitting behind a big desk.
Right. So it was the same dynamics. And that definitely
right,
gets passed down to kids because you've
right,
seen that as a model.
Right. Right. So
right,
it was not abnormal to me. But the point I make is a lot of minority women don't have that model.
Right.
And we now have to be very intentional.
They don't have that model. And also
right,
in our communities, there are no models
there
as well
none,
sometimes to...
Right.
For a child or a little girl to look up to and say, I want to be like her when
right,
I grow up.
Right.
You know, so it's like.
So for those
yeah,
who do have that, me included.
Yeah.
You have to step up to the responsibility of allowing them to see you as that. Right.
Right.
I took a step back from technology. I did technology for about 23 years. Very high level New York Stock Exchange, you know, top technology position. And then kind of just had a little bit needed to take a break after my husband passed away. And one of the things that brought me back was my realization that there were so many young girls out there. The goals are to get young women of color into technology. Well, they're not going to do that if they don't see me.
Right. If they don't see you as a model, as an example, as someone that they can aspire to be.
Right. And every time I spoke somewhere, they would flock to me. Right. Because there aren't that many of me running around.
Right.
Right.
Right. Right.
And so it becomes that it is my responsibility, right, to model that for them. And for those parents who aren't able or don't really get that, right, mm-hmm. it becomes their responsibility to say you can be that.
Right.
But for them to say you can be that, they have to break through their own box mentality.
Now, has it been difficult for you to break through, like they call the glass ceiling, breaking through to be that example? Yes. Because, you know, sometimes like we say, let's be the model, the example. Right. But was it hard get there?
It was hard.
In what sense?
I'll tell you a funny story. I remember very clearly, and this was a pivotal point in my career. I was pregnant with my second son, and I was like, you know, why can't I have it all? I was married. Right. I had my first son, got pregnant with my second son at my job, you know, and I'm like, you know, yeah, I'm going to have a second kid, and then I'm coming back to work. And my boss at the time said to me, oh, you're having a second kid. You're not coming back.
You're not. But you know what? Yeah. That is the stigma that we have as women.
Yes.
In the workforce, in the work field.
Yes.
Once you become a mom, that's it. Your career is over. And I've seen that in entertainment and television, where I have even a lot of friends that are either models on TV.
Right.
So many people. And it is changing. But so many people, that's the first thing. Your career is over.
Yeah. That he literally said that to me. He said.
And what'd you say to him?
So I said, no, I'm not. I'll be back. And more importantly, I put a plan together for my maternity leave of what I needed them to do. Right. That was like, because I am coming back. And it was funny because he really didn't believe it. But I was at a critical point where I was starting the creation of a function in the organization that was sorely needed and became critical that I ended up going back and doing globally.
Wow.
Right. And it started with that project. And so I saw the vision about creating something that could be replicated and done across the world. And he saw me as a pregnant woman on the way with her second kid.
Right.
Who's going to be home, you know.
Taking care of the baby and then not coming back.
And that's it. Which is not a bad thing. I washed bottles.
Right, right. And you know what?
I wanted more.
I always say that every person and every woman has different aspirations and dreams.
Right.
Being a mother is valid. Like if you want to be a mother, housewife, and stay at home raising your children, that is valid as well.
It's
a job within its own, within itself.
Entirely.
Very difficult job, you know?
Yeah.
But if you have other dreams, and I think that this is where a lot of women of color, a lot of women in minority communities, their life ends.
Yeah.
When or their dreams end when they get married and have a child.
Yeah.
Like it's like everything takes a step back. Right. And that's when you see a lot of women later on reaching a midlife crisis when they say, oh my God, my kids are grown. They might be divorced or, you know, or whatever situation it is. And then they start to look at who am I? What am I doing? What, why did I leave my dreams?
Right.
At the doorstep and never pursued them. Yeah, so I always say, don't let go of your dreams. Try to make them work with you, you know, like if you're going to start a family, start your family, but don't leave behind your dreams.
Absolutely. And for me, it's interesting because I could have never played it out the way it ended up happening. Right. And so I tell you about this guy. I ultimately went back. He actually ended up reporting to me. He was my boss when I left.
And he ended up reporting.
He ended up reporting to me because I was a visionary.
Right.
And I saw the end goal and I was willing to execute to that. And it was weird. But bottom line is, fast forward, I don't know, maybe 8 years, Dom, my husband, gets sick. He passes away. Now imagine if I hadn't pursued some of these things that I really wanted to pursue.
Right.
I consider myself to now be a role model for my sons.
Right.
They don't happen to have their dad here.
So I'm taking
both roles. But the career side, they're getting from me.
Right.
Otherwise, I may not have been able to help them from a career perspective about what to go do. But because I stuck with that, I am now able to fill that role in addition to the other roles that I fill now. It's not my ideal. It's not what I would normally have wanted to have happen, but it did happen because life happens.
I wanted to ask you that because before being on camera, we were talking a little bit about that and how many times we wish ourselves into wishful thinking. Right. And there's always, you know, what you want and what you wish for and right. what God has in what, store for yes. you. How do you prepare for something like that? Because, you know, like, let's say you always want what's best. Every single human being, it doesn't matter what color, creed, where you're from, general sexual preference.
Right.
Everyone has the same core desire.
Right.
Happiness and well-being.
Absolutely.